Yeah, thank you. Wow. Thanks, everyone, for showing up. And I thank Mark and Todd for creating this opportunity, you know, for all of us to get together and talk about AI. Mark is really one of the greatest community organizers I know, and he really made this company we worked at together, cloud.com, successful. You know, that was more than a decade ago, and when we were still at the early years of cloud adoption. So now we're onto the next challenge, AI adoption, and it's really not a surprise that Mark is jumping to it, and you know, I think all of us will make this whole thing happen again. So these are, I'm sure you've heard about both, and they're actually the number one and number two consumer AI apps in the world right now. Of course, it's quite impressive that ChatGPT got there in about 2 years. It's probably perhaps even more impressive that DeepSeek got there in a little bit over 2 months. But still, I mean, but you look at these numbers, you still kind of realize how much more AI needs to go before, say, it reaches the level of adoption or democratization as other technologies like, say, the internet, the phone, the smartphone, mobile internet, so e-commerce. This AI has a long way to go, right? To actually get to that level of adoption, like, you know, amongst the billions of the population in the world. These are practically, we're still practically only talking to very early adopters. One area we kind of always thought AI would be able to do more, which I still think really is lacking, is in the workspace. You know, there's a lot of, I don't think these days people are particularly worried about AGI taking over people's jobs anymore, because it still hasn't happened. I don't think there's any danger of it happening anytime soon. But how about AI just being more helpful? And I think if you're a developer, I think we all appreciate, you know, the power of GitHub Copilot or things like that. But, you know, if you're a lawyer, you're a salesperson, I mean, you look upon your daily work routine, like, how much is AI really helping? And I think it's honestly quite lacking. You know, the ChatGPT is quite useful, you know, gathering information from the web, from the public web, maybe to some degree takes over the role of a search engine. But still, you know, how can we really make AI to be more useful? So this is something the whole AI technology community has been working on, and we've also been really working on. And I think the community as a whole kind of concluded that if we basically, chatbots are clearly gaining adoption, but how can we get these things to do more? And just in no particular order, those are just some of the areas that I think the industry as a whole has recognized that we got to do, right? I mean, first of all, I mean, I think the simplest thing is the stuff on the left side, instructions. So that's like prompt engineering. Like, part of it that we realize is just to give these chatbots better instructions. And you wouldn't believe that a lot of times, you know, there's a discipline of prompt engineering. And even when I talked to some ChatGPT users, they didn't even realize what ChatGPT could do just by prompting it. And you know, I was talking to a teacher. She was absolutely amazed that I was able to show her this test that for a certain grade level, for a certain subject, that I was able to generate just by a simple prompt. But more importantly, I was able to get ChatGPT to grade that test with another prompt, right? But these are, I mean, obviously pretty simple ideas, but these even haven't been, that kind of knowledge hadn't been particularly well understood, and the one on the top says knowledge. You know, there's this public knowledge out there. This is the all the base training set that goes to the foundation model, but you know, that's what gets us into RAG and all the enhancements to RAG. What about the domain knowledge? What about the behind the firewall knowledge? So there's a lot more we can do there. Memory, you know, as all of you guys, if you know about how AI really works, it is a stateless machine. It's literally like when you chat with a model, it's literally taking your entire chat history and then feed it to the model every time, getting the next response. So it's almost like a quadratic behavior kind of thing, right? That's kind of what's going on. The model really doesn't remember anything. So anything you got to remember, you got to build it outside of the model. Then tools. You know, these are tools has been one of the major innovations of agent that what kind of brought us agentic AI in probably in the last couple of years. You know, before tools usage, AI is pretty much only good at answering questions. But now the AI not only can answer questions, but it can also instruct you to use a tool. Like you ask it, what's the temperature in Durham today or tomorrow? Like it wouldn't know, like it makes something up. But then it could, then you said there's also a tool called weather. And then the weather can take an argument called date and location, right? And then it has the semantic knowledge to know when you ask about temperature, that means weather, so it'll actually say, why don't you just call this weather function and then pass it, you know, Durham, North Carolina, and the date of tomorrow, then you'll be able to get the information back. So this is quite powerful. You know, I'm sure all of you, if I rob you today of all the tools you have, you're probably gonna get very little done in terms of, you know, your job or the daily life. So tools are very important. And then the other thing that we've all realized is this sort of the cognitive help. You know, the language models are generally pretty good at doing what you tell it to do. But just like humans are pretty good at it too. But just like humans, sometimes they get lost when you just tell it too many things at once. You know, that's why like in the human world, we have things like, especially in mission critical environments, we have things like run books. You know, you gotta follow, like if you're flying an airplane, you need checklists, right? You can't really rely on the brain to remember, these are the five things you need to, even though it's just really just five, but you gotta do it one by one. So it turned out that that language models frequently need that kind of support as well. And you know, frequently people call it, these days just call it tasks, but you know, it's in general you can call it a workflow, but that's the sort of stuff that you also got to maintain for LLM. So I would say in the last couple of years, the industry as a whole has been kind of building these things. There are various kind of frameworks, and you will hear they are generally be called AI agent frameworks. But so we build a piece of open source software called Obot. That implement all of that stuff. So I'll kind of give you a real quick 3-minute walkthrough of that, just to give you an idea how all these concepts could come together. And it's, like I said, it's 100% open source software, but we also stood up a website, like a SaaS called Obot.ai that you're welcome to go take a look. And the first thing you'll see is there's a whole bunch of chatbots there already, just to kind of showcase, you know, what this thing can do. Like the first one you see, it says Slack to GitHub. So you click into it, it's basically something that take your Slack chat and turn into a GitHub issue. So that's quite useful for if you're an engineering team, right? You can kind of do it in one shot. But this thing is not just a bunch of ready-made chatbots. One area that I'm gonna kind of quickly go through and show what this thing's about is you can build your own chatbots. So to create your own chatbots, you click, I want to create my own chatbot. Then you get into an editor. And typically, you know, the first thing you do is you'll give it a name, give it a description, and give it some high-level instruction. Like I said earlier, I said instruction. That's where prompt engineering comes in. It says your autonomous agent screening incoming job applications, because this is actually a problem I personally have. You know, the job market isn't great today, so if I just put on a job ad, there are literally like dozens of resumes coming in every day. And most of them are clearly not a match. Some of them are basically ads from recruiting agencies. Some of them are just cold call emails from random places. So you got to deal with all of that. And I can do it a few days, but a few days later, I get really bored and I stop following the resume, and perfectly good candidates are slipping through. So it's something that I thought, maybe I'll try to build some AI stuff to help me. So that's kind of what I'm trying to do. And since I'm screening emails, early on I said tools, right? Like AI really can use tools. So I pick a tool called Outlook Email. I pick some other tools. So this thing allows me to do that. Then, remember, here I'm trying to screen resumes according to some job descriptions. So I'm gonna pick, you know, particular job descriptions that I'm responsible for. So since I'm an engineer, I'll pick, you know, just I'm an engineering manager. I'm particularly looking for two kind of roles. One is an AI applications engineer. The other is a DevOps engineer. So I added these two job descriptions in my knowledge base. So now let's give it a try. I said list all the emails in the incoming resumes folder, and indeed it did. Like, it actually works. You know, AI LLM is now interfacing with my Outlook email, and it listed 18. Man, that came during that one day. That's actually already quite a lot. But now I want to say, you know, I really don't want to look through those 18 resumes. There's too many. So just list the matches that list the resumes that match one of my job descriptions. So now you see the power of LLM comes in. It actually looks at the resume, match it against, take the job description out of my knowledge base and match them and say, there's only four. Oh, that's great. But the thing is, four is relevant. That's just already reduced my workload, right? But the problem is I don't wanna, like, it listed four, but today there'll be four, tomorrow there'll be three. So I wanna make sure I don't lose the result. So one thing I would do is, how about I create table? I create memory for the LLM. I say, create a table with three columns, name of the applicant, resume, and the job role they're applying. So it says, yeah, I created it. It's like a database. then I say, just save those four job descriptions into this table. It did it. I want to make sure it's really saved. So you see here, it's indeed saved four people. That's great. But I don't want to do it every day, like type these instructions, right? So that's where the checklist, the tasks come in. So now I get into this stuff, create a task, and I said every day at 9 a.m., you know, before I start working, it runs through these four steps. It says, fetch all the emails, find the resume. It's basically what I typed before. Save it in the table, and then send me an email. Just remind me, you know, this thing has happened. And that's it. That's basically how it works. So say I'm an engineering manager. I find this stuff quite useful to me. But then there's a sales manager said he wants to use it too. So I want to share this Obot with him or her. So this is almost like a Google Doc. I can just say click and share. So the sales manager gets it and she's like, oh, actually it works, but obviously I want to go and further refine it. I want to edit it because your Obot has, you know, two job descriptions of engineer, so she'll replace it with her job descriptions and it'll work for her. So this is what we really envision a chatbot could be enhanced to actually work more like an assistant, or in the extreme case, almost like an autonomous agent, right? So now hopefully you see, with open source software, with the capabilities early on was talking about instructions, knowledge, tools, tasks, memory, files, databases, all these things can come together and actually make these chatbot, next generation chatbot useful to improve your productivity. So hopefully now I give you an idea, and I would definitely encourage you to, you know, go to this website, obot.ai, and you can try it out yourself. today. And this is, again, 100% open source software, so you can download it, and you can set up your own instance, and if you're worried about, you know, your information, because this thing is actually connecting with your, you know, with your enterprise applications. If you're ever worried about this stuff gets into a web service, then you run it on your own infrastructure, and it'll be completely safe. So hopefully we can all work together. This is still a work in progress. I will appreciate feedback, and hopefully we can work together to make this a wide adoption of AI, and especially make it possible for AI to help us improve our work productivity. Okay, thank you.